really exciting project that I've had going on for the last couple of years about trying to collect an all rafe and fish morpho space using crowdsourcing. So the motivation behind this sort of study is to understand what are the patterns that lead to unevenness and species richness across the tree of life. We have this hypothesis about evolvability, right? Lineages with an intrinsic ability to evolve novel morphologies, and there's a couple of different hypotheses that are proposed to see, okay, what exactly is going on with the unevenness and species richness. And the one that we're going to look at today is the idea that high rates of speciation and phenotypic evolution are in fact correlated. This is something that we found in a previous study with Bosky et al. 2013. In that study, we looked at body size and speciation rate. Here, we're going to try to look at body shape and speciation rate in the rafe fishes. One of the things that has been a problem is that we have this new ability to build massive phylogenies using lots and lots of molecular sequence data. But when we have these really broad scale analyses, we're still using relatively simplistic traits, things like body size, feeding mode, or even something just something like species richness. And I want to argue that for richer inference on the fish tree of life and on across all of the comparative biology, we need more detailed data in order to do these sorts of work. The challenge then is collecting enough data at scale and at detailed enough data in order to make this sort of thing possible. Our ability to generate large phenotypic data sets has not kept pace with our ability to generate large molecular sequence databases. So the question is, you know, where is the room for morphology? Where is it for phenotypic trait data? And I propose that one of the solutions to this problem might be using crowdsourcing to split up these tasks, parallelize them, and get morphological data really, really quickly. And so I accomplished this using Amazon Mechanical Turk. Amazon Mechanical Turk, the tagline is artificial intelligence. And the basic idea is that we're able to harness human workers' compute power, their brains, in exchange for a small, you know, financial transaction. And to accomplish this, I built a web-based landmarking application, and it's been called TPS Dig in the Cloud by a collaborator. And using this application, I first did a pilot study that looked at turker performance across 9 families of fishes and compared their performance to a panel of experts who also performed the same task, just to see how turkers did compared to the experts. And then I also distributed 8,400 images of rafe and fishes to these turkers to collect a morpho space for all fishes at 5x replication. So the study comparing the performance between experts and turkers, we see that for these 9 different families, I have outlined in white the median shape of all turkers versus the median shape of all experts. And from this morpho space projection, we can see that the shapes are actually not that different. Turkers and experts tend to converge on the same sort of shape configuration. And in fact, when we do a Pacruski's ANOVA, it's unable to detect a significant difference between a shape configuration produced by a turker and a shape configuration produced by a morphologist. The other nice thing about using crowdsourcing is that it's very, very high throughput, just like the next-gen sequencing techniques that we know and love. For the previous data set to get this at 5x replication, turkers took 5 hours, but if a single expert wanted to do the same task at 1x replication, it would take over 30 times as long. Okay, so the raw speed up of this technique is not something to be taken lightly. Alright, so I distributed all these images to my turkers. The reason why we do this is because rafe and fishes represent over half of vertebrate diversity. In my data set, I have 8,400 species, so that's a little less than a third of all fish diversity. I have over 2/3 of families covered and over 90% of orders represented in this data set. And I constructed a morphospace using the Amazon mechanical Turk data based on 16 geometric morphometric landmarks. So here's the morphospace. On the x-axis we have PC1, on the y-axis we have PC2. PC1 here corresponds roughly to the length of the fish base as it attaches on the body of the fish, and PC2 is roughly where exactly those fins are placed on the body. This suggests some sort of broad disparity between all fishes in their local motor ability. But fin position can actually be misleading. Fishes have multiple fins that they can use in various ways to move around the water. And since we only measured three sets of fins, there can be other ones coming into play. You know, some fish have multiple dorsal fins that do different things. So it's suggestive, but there might not be a whole lot there. If we look at PCs 3 and 4, here's where we start to get into more functional traits that are very, very suggestive of what's going on across all fishes. PC3 represents dorsal ventral compression, so how the fish is squished this way. And PC4 represents body elongation, when you pull the fish out like this from head to tail. And these, again, are likely functional. These have been associated with things like locomotion in complex environments like coral reefs. And it's also been suggested that, you know, being really, really deep body might be a predator defense against predators that are limited in their ability to open their mouth to get their mouth around a piece of prey. And here I have PC 1, 2, 3, and 4, PC 1 and 2 on the left, and PC 3 and 4 on the right, and a couple of different groups of fishes that we might be interested in. So two groups of freshwater fishes, the cichlids in red, and the cyprinids in blue, and also all reef fishes, reef-associated fishes, in blue. And one of the things that's really cool about this is that cichlids and cyprinids are both really, really young groups of freshwater fishes. Cyprinids are something like 40 million years old, cichlids something around 60, and yet in that short span of time, they've been able to occupy over two-thirds of fish morphospace, and in PCs 2 and 3, pretty much, or PCs 3 and 4, pretty much all of the morphospace there. So that's really exciting result, I think, because it suggests that those groups are doing something particularly special in order to cover that much area of morphospace in such a short period of time. And related to that idea, we also want to sort of get this idea, okay, how does the rate of phenotypic evolution vary across the range of fishes? And to do this, I use a program written by Dan Boskin colleagues called DAM, which can estimate rates of species diversification and also phenotypic evolution across the phylogeny. And so I used that, I threw in those PC-shaped axes as continuously valued traits on a previously published phylogeny in Rabowski et al. 2013. And the idea is that, okay, when and where are these hotspots of phenotypic evolution across the fish tree of life? Where's fish shape changing most rapidly? And one of the things that we get is this rates through time plot. So the x-axis is time, and the y-axis is a rate of shape evolution. And what's really, really cool is that right here, we recover a peak at around 100 million years. And this peak stands up pretty starkly in contrast to the background rate of shape evolution in the raging fishes. And this is consistent with a number of previous studies. So Tom Neer, 2013, looked at spiny reef fishes and just found a similar peak in diversification at around 100 million years. And also Matt Friedman, in a single author paper in 2010, used paleontological data with morphology and also recovered a similar peak. 100 million years ago, that's the end Cretaceous event, so it's really exciting that we can use extant phenotypic data to recover the same sort of, to corroborate this evidence across different lines of evidence in these two other studies. And so there's a lot going on in this morphospace. We hope to get into it more over the next couple of months and see what we can learn about fishes. To sum up, we've generated the largest ever morpho space with 8,400 species. Hopefully I've shown to you that crowdsourcing can be a really, really powerful tool to gather detailed data quickly across larger numbers of specimens. And that the data generated in this way can be used to make inferences about the tree of life at phenomic scales. With that said, I'd like to thank you guys for listening. I'd also like to thank my very, very patient funding source at the Encyclopedia of Life, and also my collaborators, Matt McGee and Sam Borstein, who contributed a lot of their own images to this project, and also, of course, all of my mechanical third workers. Thank you very much. Sort of study? The answer is yes, I did. I wrote a very, very long protocol document that described exactly how it is I wanted it to be carried out, and I wrote a three-question quiz to test the worker's knowledge. And that seemed to be sufficient to sort of weed out the people who were sort of unwilling to take the time to learn the protocol. But as of this morning, about 800 workers had taken the test, and of those 800, about 224 had completed at least one assignment. So the question was, how expensive is it to hire this many turkers? At the rates that I pay, it is about $1 a species. In terms of wages, depending on how fast people work, this ranges from $10 to $20 an hour. This is actually comparatively generous pay for an Amazon Mechanical Turk professor. Usually they pay a lot less, but I didn't want to be cruel. So I'm glad you asked that question. I'm giving a poster tomorrow that covers this exact topic, and you can chat with me there. But basically, yes, I did get an estimate error. What I found was that for the most part, experts had lower variance in their estimates, so they're better. They agree with each other more for most points. So generally, yes, the experts are better, but it took a very long time to find six people to do this task for me, so my argument is that the data might be a little bit less good,